Abba Father, Daddy God, you have all of our attention. Abba Father, it's my prayer that every word that proceeds from my mouth, Abba Father, I pray that it will be 100% in line with your word. I pray, Abba Father, any word that I speak that is not 100% in line with your word, I pray, Abba Father, that you will take such words from my mouth. For when we teach your word, Abba Father, there is no place for man's opinion. Because man's opinion creates division. And your word unites, Lord. Your word is truth, and your word unites the bride, Abba Father. I pray, Abba Father, that we will drink from your pure word, Abba Father. Touch us, Daddy God, in the way that only you can. We praise you and we worship you in the mighty name of Yeshua. Amen. This morning we're going to start off with a very familiar story in the word of Abba Father. It's a story about when Yeshua freed the man who was possessed from the demonic forces. And we all know the story when the demonic forces went into a herd of pigs or swine and ran down the cliff. But it's also a scripture used as very controversial, because many times people who try to prove that there are inconsistencies in the word of Abba Father use this very scripture. And I will tell you why. So before we even start with the story, maybe we can just wipe that out of the way. Because many times people would say, yes, but if you read the account of the story in Mark 5 or Luke 8, you see that the word of Abba Father says, when Yeshua came to the shore and he got out of the boat, a man possessed came running to him. You read the same account in Matthew 8. It says that two men came running to Yeshua that stayed amongst the tombs and in the graveyard. So then people say, that try to prove these inconsistencies. You see, the one says one man and the other one says more than one man. But you see, that's why it's important, Prince says, of Abba Father, to study the word. Because the moment you read the context of the word, the moment you go into the picture of the Greek in this case, everything falls in place. Because then you see, when you study the Greek, you see it's a writing style. And I will explain that to you, because let's say, for example, I would speak to you and I would say to you, yesterday I walked in Cradlestone and I saw Josie. And Josie came to me and he spoke to me and he asked me to pray for him. And in Cradlestone we stood there and we prayed. It doesn't mean he was alone. You see, in Greek there's what they call this singular writing style or plural writing style. In other words, Josie could have been with Karen and their children. But my focus was my prayer to Josie. So when I tell it, you may have this picture of I walked in Cradlestone, I walked into Josie and we prayed together. Because I merely did not mention who he was with, because it wasn't necessary. So you look at the writing style in Greek, you see that Mark 5 and Luke 8 is written in what they call the singular writing style. In other words, it was focused on the work that Yeshua did. And Matthew was describing, when you read it in Matthew 8, he was describing the situation and everyone that was present. But he still speaks about Yeshua freeing the man that was possessed. So we've got to see that picture, and sometimes we just need to study the context of the word before we make all kinds of assumptions. But back to our story. Because Yeshua, if you look at the Sea of Galilee, a lot of his work he did on the side of Capernaum and Bethsaida and many of the cities that was on the one side of the Sea of Galilee. And a few times he went across the sea to the other side. The other side was a pagan side. Because the people on the other side, as we will read when we continue, they were pagans. They did not believe in Yeshua. They did not really believe in Abba Father. And we will see as we continue to read in that. And in Mark 5, if we were to take that account, Yeshua calls his disciples, and the first thing he does is he goes across to the pagan side to speak to this man who was in bondage of demonic forces. The word says he went across the Sea of Galilee to a place, to the Gadarenes. Now, Gadarenes in Greek means a reward at the end. Ringing a bell, a reward at the end. I want you to keep that in mind, because at the end of today, it's all going to come together. A reward at the end. So as I've said, this area in the time of Yeshua was a pagan area. So the word says they go across the Sea of Galilee, and as Yeshua gets out of the boat, the word says immediately a man with an unclean spirit, in other words, demon possessed, came from the tombs, came running to him. You can read that in Mark 5 verse 2. Now let's just pause for a moment, because if you look at the Greek word for tombs, this place where this man was stuck, this place where this man resided every day of his life. The root word for tombs, obviously the Greek word for tombs means a graveyard where people are buried. But if you look at the root word in Greek, it means, listen to this, to always live in that place of remembrance of that which is of death. Pause. Oh, but this happened to me 20 years, 10 years, 5 years, 2 years, and I can never sometimes get out of that space of the time when I was in death. That time when I was in Egypt, that time when I was entrapped and in bondage of sin. And this very picture is to bring into remembrance, to always live in that place of remembrance of that which was of death. Listen to the root word. It means to be stuck in a place of death and darkness. In other words, it doesn't matter what you hear. You just, but. And then you just return to the darkness and you return to the bondage. Because some or other way, the enemy has convinced you that that is your portion. And we're going to see what the word of Abba Father teaches us today. Ek moet vir jou 'n woord gee, anders gaan ek ongehoorsaam wees aan Abba Vader. Abba Vader, wys my hierdie prentjie, Boeta, van hoe jy so staan met jou hand so uit, en ek wil hê met jou hand so vuis maak, en so uitsit, en ek ervaar hierdie prentjie van hoe Abba Vader jou hand kom oopmaak, and he places in your hand, soos hierdie gerf van wheat, wat hy so in jou hand sit, en dan maak hy jou hand so toe, en ek vraag, Abba Vader, wat is hy prentjie, en ek ervaar hoe Abba Vader vir my sê, those who I have equipped, I entrust in bringing in the harvest, en ek ervaar hoe Abba Vader sê, nie twyfel nie, ek ervaar hoe Abba Vader vir my wys, dat baie keer het jy al getwyfel en gesê, Abba Vader, what is my role, where am I to fit in, waar moet ek inpas, Abba Vader, hoe bou ek hierdie koninkryk, en ek ervaar hoe Abba Vader sê, I've called you into this season, now in this place, I've equipped you, everything you've eaten from my word has equipped you for this very time. En ek ervaar hoe Abba Vader sê, those who adhere and obey to my word, I entrust in bringing in the harvest and tell my son that he will play a profound role in bringing in the harvest in these end times. Mag dit so wees, en dit wat jy doen. So we're going to read from Mark 5 verse 3. So the word speaks about this man who lived amongst the tombs, and then it says, verse 3, who had his dwelling amongst the tombs, and no man could bind him, no, not with chains. Pause. Isaiah 65 teaches us, he who lives amongst the tombs, it's pagan behavior. So he testifies of the fact that Yeshua set his foot on pagan country in that time. Verse 4 of Mark 5. Because he had been often bound with fetters and chains, and the chains had been plucked asunder by him, and the fetters broken in pieces, neither could any man tame him. There's a profound lesson in spiritual warfare in this one verse. No man could tame him, because we can't use the natural to tame the spiritual. It's impossible to do that. That's why Paul writes in 2 Corinthians 10 verse 4. That's why he says our weapons in spiritual warfare are not carnal, but are spiritual, to break down the strongholds. So they try to tame him with chains, but being demon possessed can't be tamed with physical chains. It's not going to work. I cannot do that. Because the spirit realm, we know, supersedes and governs the natural realm. That's what the word of Abba Father teaches us. Verse 5, and always night and day he was in the mountains. And in the tombs, crying and cutting himself with stones. Pause. Cutting himself with stones. That self-harm of cutting yourself was a well-established ritual in demon worship. Remember, if you read 1 Kings 18, Verse 28, when Elijah came against the prophets of Baal, when they prayed and prayed and prayed and prayed to their pagan God, what did they do? They cut themselves. So it's this picture of being forced into that place of demonic worship. Because demonic worship will always lead to self-harm. And we're going to see how that works. But when he saw Jesus afar off, verse 6, he ran and worshipped him. That word for worship is to bow in his presence, because every knee will bow and every tongue will confess. That doesn't matter how many demonic forces, how many demons occupied this man. Every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that he is Lord. Verse 7. and cried with a loud voice and said, What have I to do with thee, Jesus, thou Son of the Most High God? I adjure thee by God that thou not torment me. Can you see something here? I adjure thee by God that thou not torment me. Can you see the tactic of the enemy? Trying to get Yeshua to focus on the man? Because when Yeshua asks him what his name is, he says his name is Legio, which means many. And we know he was possessed by many demonic spirits. But the moment in spiritual warfare, the moment through Holy Spirit discernment, you discern the enemy, he tries to shift your focus to man. Because the moment he can shift your focus to man, he shifts your focus from spiritual warfare and breaking his dark forces in the spirit. So he's trying to... These demonic, these principalities and powers of darkness is trying to move the focus to the man and ask, pleading with Yeshua not to torment the man. How will Yeshua torment man if he came to die for our sins? But that's how the enemy works, because it might sound to you and me, it might sound... Yeah, that's quite logical. But how many times when we are confronted by someone that is under oppression or even possession of demonic forces, we focus on the man and we start attacking the man and fighting the man or the woman? Because that's the first tactic of the enemy. Moses. Well, that woman, you know, crazy. And that's all the enemy wants to do, is build this facade so that we don't see and discern the principality and power of darkness behind this bondage. Because he knows the moment we discern him, his time is up. In that vessel. So if we look at this man, I just want to draw this picture for you, because this man was without rest. He was without sleep, naked, running around between the tombs, day and night, wandering by himself in the mountains, howling and crying, the word says. This crying, if you look at the Greek word, it says, he croaked like a raven. This man was so hurt. Listen to the Greek. He croaked like a raven out of a place of despair. He was without peace of mind. He cut himself in this forced demonic worship because he was bound. His body was battered. He was full of scars and bruises, dirty, wounded, bleeding, filthy in the natural. And I'm not going to touch this guy. Terror to himself and to others. Because they pushed him out of the town. You go live amongst the tombs. Without a house, without friends, without family, alone. Living a life cast out in the land of the dead. I think it's fair to say that he was without hope. Crying out. You see, the enemy got into that place where he isolated him in that emptiness of death. And if we pause for a moment, I want to tell you, if you look at that picture in Greek, you see that this is a description of the place where the enemy ultimately wants anyone to be over which he has bondage. In other words, if you are bound, if you are not freed by the blood of the Lamb, living in that bondage, that is the enemy's dream for you, to be isolated in that place of death. And this is a vivid picture that the word of Abba Father draws for us. This is what happens when you are in the world. This is what you look like in the spirit, Gary. This is what you looked like for many years, Gary. And then he saw Messiah. Then he sees Messiah getting off the boat, stepping onto this land. He runs to him and he refers to him as Son of the Most High. Now there's a very profound reason why he uses Son of, and he uses the description of Abba Father of the Most High in Hebrew, El Elyon. Because this term is used in the word of Abba Father to emphasize the power and authority that Abba Father has over pagan deities. Every time in the word, Numbers 24, Isaiah 14, when you read about the authority and power that Abba Father has over pagan gods or pagan deities, he uses El Elyon. So in the midst of his hurt, possessed by these principalities and powers of darkness, he's still a created being by the Most High God. And he sees Messiah stepping off the boat. He sees salvation. And he runs to him. And in that, in the way that he addresses Yeshua, he says, I now bow in the presence of the one who has power and authority over all these pagan deities that bind me. Because that is what he needed, and he runs towards salvation. The demons try and stop it to say that, Yeshua, please don't torment this man. Came for salvation, not to torment. But can you see what the enemy does? And how many times, and that's where we're going to in this journey this morning, how many times does he get us to back out of war because he places fear in our hearts? Because he knows. The moment I persevere, the moment I set my face like flint, and I move in the authority and power of the great I am, he's in trouble. The enemy knows that. So he always throws these things in front. Let's continue to read verse 8, Mark 5. For Yeshua said unto him, Come out of the man, thou unclean spirit. And he asked, What is thy name? And he answered, saying, My name is Legion, for we are many. See, the moment Yeshua discerned, then he says, and you read the Greek of that, it's not, My name is Legion, we are many. All of a sudden, then he says, My name is Legion, and you read the Greek, he's trying to intimidate Yeshua. I just want to tell you, before you start fighting with us, we're a lot, we're many. Ooh. Because many people try to say, but there were so many demons, and so many demons. The word doesn't say that there were 2,000 demons. The word says there were 2,000 pigs. But legion in the Roman army was 6,000 soldiers. But that doesn't mean that they were 6,000. The term he's using is to say, listen, you're up against the army, Yeshua. Can you see how he changes his tactic? Before he was discerned, he said, please don't torment this man, trying to get Yeshua to back off. Because he knows that Yeshua loves the man. So he's trying to get the man to run away and not come closer. And that's what he does with us. He tries to get us to back off through fear. But Yeshua discerns and he says, what's your name? And he just gives this collective name and just says, we are many. We are many. Now that you've seen us, I just want to tell you, we're a whole army. That's how the enemy works, because he tries to get us to back out of spiritual warfare. Verse 10. And he besought him much that he would not send them out of the country. Now there were near to them in the mountains a great herd of swine feeding. And all the devils besought him, saying, send us into the swine that we may enter into them. First thing we need to understand in this, and we did that in our previous series, we know why this man calls out to Yeshua and calls him Son of the Most High. We also see that the demons knew exactly who Yeshua was. Remember in our series when we did Acts 19 verse 15, when the demonic forces in the sons of Sceva said, Yeshua we know, Paul we know, but who are you? Same thing. They knew exactly who Yeshua was, because they once, before Isaiah 14, before Ezekiel 28, they worshipped him. And then Lucifer rose in pride, and Revelation 12 says, a third of the angels were thrown out of heaven with him. They know exactly who Yeshua is. And we see that. The third thing we need to understand is the enemy will always attack the image of Yahweh. He will always attack everything in your life that looks like Abba Father. Think about that. Just think about that for a moment. We are made to the image of Abba Father, and that is why the enemy hates us. And he wants to attack that image of Yahweh Elohim inside us, which we were created to, and he wants to conform us to the image of the world. He wants to wreck the image of Yahweh. What did he say in Isaiah 14, the enemy? I want to be like who? The Most High. And now that you understand El Elyon, it's the very name of Yahweh that declares that he's got power and authority over all pagan deities. That's why the enemy wanted to be there, because he wants the authority and the power. And that's what he rebelled against. And that's why he said to Adam and Eve, God is just scared that you will be like him. That's why he doesn't want you to eat from the fruit. So these demonic forces say to Yeshua, we are many, trying to intimidate him. But he just says, okay, go, leave. Cheers. I don't know. I don't see Yeshua hitting the man in the stomach, shouting, binding him, dragging him around. The word simply says, he told them to leave. He told them to leave. Because authority, spiritual authority, is not in volume. It's in the name of Messiah. Power and authority lies in the great I Am. So therefore, I can move to somebody in Satanism and just say, you principalities and powers of darkness, go. In this tone of voice, and they have to go. Because it's not about the volume, it's It's about the one who resides in me. That's why the Satanic Church in Pretoria, the leader was freed with a hug. With a hug from a woman at a radio station. He cries, this guy, that his energy was, he says himself, his energy was generated in hate. And he cries and he says, I've never seen that love. She didn't say a word. That's the authority of a vessel carrying the presence of the great I Am. And we have to understand that. For a moment, if you read this, it almost looks as if Yeshua adhered to the demonic forces, saying, listen, drive us into the pigs, let us go there. It's almost as if he obeyed them. If you read it on face value, but not at all. Because if you, and we don't have time, but if you take all the Greek pictures and you put them together and you study this, and you study the account of this in Luke 8, and you see that there's something very amazing happening in this. Because if Yeshua adhered to the request of the demonic forces, why does he then tell us to handle principalities and powers of darkness differently? Because Luke 10 verse 19, he says, you tread on serpents and scorpions. So why would he say that and then he accommodates demonic forces? Maybe because he didn't. Because if you read this part of scripture, you see that it's not the case at all. You see, and listen to this, because this is a beautiful picture. Yeshua, the enemy tried in Yeshua's life, in all the temptations, he tried to get Yeshua to deviate from the salvation plan of the Father. That's all he tried to do. And Yeshua would not deviate from that which the Father sent him to do. And the salvation plan of Abba Father was victory on the cross of Calvary. And Yeshua was on his way to the cross, where the bondage of sin would be broken, where the hold of death would be broken, where the power of principalities of darkness would be broken permanently, totally broken. No other victory was necessary. And he knew this because the salvation plan was designed by the Father. And that is why Paul writes to the Colossians, and he writes in Colossians 2 verse 15, he says, having stripped rulers and authorities, he made a show of them publicly, triumphing over them. He made a spectacle in public of the principalities and powers of darkness on the cross of Calvary. The victory was done, finished. It is done. It's finished. And he was on his way there, and all the enemy tried to do was get him to deviate from this. And he was on his way. We've got to see that picture, that he was on his way to the cross. He wasn't going to negotiate with the principalities and powers of darkness. Listen to this, because if you read the Matthew account of this, something amazing comes out, because Matthew 8 verse 29 says, and behold, they cried out saying, these are the demonic forces that bound this man. What have we to do with thee, Jesus, Son of God? Art thou come hither to torment us before the time? Can you hear what they say? Why are you here, Yeshua? Did you come to torment us before the time? They know their time is coming. They know exactly what's going to happen. And now they see him and they say, are you now here to torment us before the time? Why are they saying before the time? Before what time? Because the appointment is there. The cross was in the near future. And the lake of fire is there, where they will be bound and thrown into for everlasting torment. So they see him, and the first thing they say, are you here to torment us before time? And we know that Abba Father will not do that. He's got his salvation plan. He sent his son to pay for our sins. Now we have to make the choice. And the appointment is set for the enemy. You read Revelation 20, you see how he will be bound, how he will be judged, and how him, all the demonic forces and all the unrighteous will be thrown into this pool and this lake of fire for everlasting, removed from the presence of the great I Am. And they say, you're a bit premature here, because they're scared. They know. So the demons enter the 2,000 swine and they run over a cliff into the sea. Isn't that so the character of the enemy? Destroys everything he enters into. Why did Yeshua kill 2,000 animals? He didn't. The principalities and powers of darkness killed him. Because they ran over the cliff. When they were controlled by, and it displays the character of the enemy. It displays the character of the enemy, the destructive nature of the enemy, because wherever he treads, he wants to destroy and kill. You've got to understand that he's the father of lies, John 8:44. Listen to what John 10 verse 10 says. The thief does not come except to steal and to kill and to destroy. But I have come that you may have life, and that you may have life in abundance. Boom. There's the separation between the two. So let's not confuse as we lay down these principles. You see, the demonic forces lost their ground to attack the man in the presence of the great I Am. Because that's what happens. And this is what Abba Father shared with me in this. And this is actually where I want to get to this morning. Because Abba Father had me face down when he showed me this. The word of Abba Father saying, after the man had been freed, the people in the town saw him. They saw the man that had been demon possessed. And he was sitting at the feet of Messiah. The word says he was clothed and he was in his right mind. In other words, he was free. Restored to that place and purpose that Abba Father had for him. That's good news, right? Wow. That is a reason to worship Yeshua and thank him. Because I mean, we had to put this guy out of town to live between the tombs because he wasn't all there. He was croaking like a raven in the pain that he had. He was cutting himself. He was naked. He was dirty. And now I see him sitting at the feet of Messiah, dressed normal, speaking like any other man. Wow. You would almost expect that the next verse would say, and they all fell on their knees and worshipped the king. But that's not what happened. The word says, and they were very afraid. How can you be more afraid of a man sitting at the feet of Messiah, normal, than a possessed man croaking like a raven? What are we missing here? Why would they see the miracle and be afraid? What is it that happened here? And Abba Father starts speaking into my heart. And we need to hear this because this is so important in the times that we live in. Sometimes we are more afraid of what Yeshua will do in our lives than the bondage that we find ourselves in. Have you seen people's hesitance? My brother, my sister, your whole life's going to change. In what way? It's a good thing. It's a touch by Messiah. It's a touch by the great I Am. But the enemy's managed to get us sometimes to be scared of a touch from the great I Am. And sometimes the lies and bondage and even the torment of the world, because it's become our normal, we are scared of the miracle, because the definition of a miracle in the word of Abba Father is a display of the explosive power of Yahweh Elohim restoring things to His normal. In other words, when Abba Father performs a miracle of, let's say, a healing, He's restoring it to His normal, because the word says in Psalm 103, He's always wanted us to be healed and healthy. But sometimes we're so used to living amongst the tombs, to living in this area of death in my life, that we, the moment He wants to touch us, the moment He invites us to say, listen, I want to break these chains, sometimes we get scared. And the moment we get scared, we push away the working of Holy Spirit. We push away Yeshua. It's crazy to see how many times the truth can scare people. Just look around you, Prince, Princess of Abba Father. Sometimes the truth terrifies people because it's out of their comfort zone. It's out of their tradition. It's out of that place that they've resided in for years. And they hear the truth and it's like, no. Let's send Yeshua out. Because the crowd, when they see this man at the feet of Messiah, when they see him sitting there, when they see him healed, the word says they beg Yeshua to leave their area. Why? Why would you do that? A man was healed. You see, sometimes this touch by Abba Father scares people because we are scared of what we will lose. We are scared to acknowledge that we were wrong. And pride kicks in. We are scared of what people will think and what people will do. We are scared of what we have to or might have to offer up in order to follow Yeshua in that fullness of covenant. You see, in the moment the enemy gets us to push away this miracle because of fear, we will always remain in the dark. Abba Father calls us to trust. So why do we get so scared of the truth many times? It's in the word of Abba Father. You see, their fear, and listen to this because this can change your life. Fear was their evidence. The fear they had was the evidence that they were carnally focused. Because fear is the evidence that I'm focused on the natural. Faith is the evidence of things not seen, Hebrews 11 verse 1. That I'm focused on the spiritual. That I'm focused on Abba Father who is spirit, John 4, 24. And fear made them foolish, like the word teaches us. And they asked the miracle maker to leave. Just get in your boat and leave. But there's something deeper in this. And I couldn't help to look at every Greek and take it back to the Hebrew and look at this picture in the word of Abba Father. And all of a sudden, something came to light. Holy Spirit shone this light on something that is so profound in this scripture. Because this story presents a huge challenge to the community. Why did they get scared? Why would they be scared of a man who was in bondage now freed? Or did they see something else? You see, you read about those times, you see the worth, the material worth of a herd of 2,000 pigs. And the community sees this man is freed, but we lost a massive herd of what we farm with in this pagan area. And then they started weighing the two. And to them, the loss of the hit they took on their economy in that town was greater than the miracle. Luckily, we don't do that, right? The loss they saw was greater than the miracle of a soul won for the kingdom of Yahweh. Because you look at these Greek pictures, their focus was on, you know how many families, herds were lost in the 2,000 swine. My whole net worth just ran into the sea. And it's your fault, Yeshua. It's your fault. So get in your boat and go. See, because the moment in this scripture, they focused on money. But the moment we focus on the natural, we miss the miracle. Because sometimes the natural and what we need here becomes more important than the miracle. And if you look at the Greek picture in this, you see that one soul, the soul of one man, is worth more to Abba Father than any amount of wealth. And that's a display in this. Because that's exactly what the enemy does. The moment you accept Yeshua, the moment Abba Father touches you, he tries to get you to fear through something, some other area in your life that he starts attacking. And he got this crowd to say, I know this guy's normal, but my pigs, my whole herd is gone. What a loss Yeshua caused to this community. Tell him to go. Tell him to go. You see, they see the restoration of the image of God in this man on the one side. A man who was possessed by principalities and powers of darkness, and they see their wiped out herd and economic loss on the other side, and they were afraid. And they asked him to rather leave. And Abba Father says to me, Harry, how many times does my children do this? When the chips are down, we choose our pigs over the miracle. Listen, Prince, Princess of Abba Father. Many times we don't like losing our pigs. And we miss the miracle that Abba Father has for us. So many times people in need are pushed aside and placed on this altar of human greed and selfishness. Time and time again, when faced with a choice of serving Yeshua, we choose our financial or natural priorities, in this case, financial. We choose to protect that. And it's not that we can only have the one and not the other. It's our first love and our first focus that He wants to be Him. I always say to people when I speak to my clients as an auditor, they many times ask me about the profit in their business. And I say to them, the moment profit shifts from being the target to being the harvest in your heart, your business will be blessed. And blessed is not always financially. It means joy, it means peace, it means many things. But you see, your bottom line, as they call it, needs to move from being the target to being the harvest, worshiping the King. Because if it's a target, I'll trade on anybody to get there. If it's a harvest, I praise the King. Because He gives it to me. We see this every day. And Abba Father says this to me, and as He said this to me, I just burst out in tears. And last night, as I sat in His presence and I heard this, I just said, Lord, please help me, Lord, not to have my focus on this. Because Abba Father's got this way of speaking very directly to me. And sometimes it's like this hit with this awe and adoration, this authority, but in so much love, but you have no doubt in what He's trying to tell you. And last night, as I sat in His presence, He said, Harry, my children want Yeshua to be their Savior, but not their Lord always. Because to be their Lord, it means everything in my life is under control of Yeshua, under control of the King. Not only some areas. They want Yeshua to save them, but they don't want Him to control their whole life. They still want that say. They want Yeshua to be their Redeemer, but not their groom. Because to be a groom is a lifetime commitment. We want eternal life for tomorrow. But we deny that kingship authority of Yeshua over us and our decisions today. But we want everlasting life. When I die, I want to go to heaven. But the day-to-day running of my life, I'll just keep control, Lord. Just want to have a say. Can we see how the enemy binds us? When He is King and Lord of our lives, our bridegroom, He controls everything. We pray about everything. So listen to what happens. They do not care about what Yeshua, the King of Kings, had just done. They focus on their financial loss. And isn't that sometimes why we are so scared? You see this time and time again. You speak to people, I even get this question directly. Okay, what do I have to give up in order to walk with Yeshua? What do I have to give up in order to enter covenant? Everything. That's the answer. Because if I don't surrender it, it's an idol. And Abba Father says, break down the idols. Trust me that I will bless you. Trust me that I will provide for you. Trust me that I will heal you. Trust me that I will guide you in every step you take. Isn't it true that sometimes we're more comfortable in the enemy's work in our lives than Abba Father's power over our lives? Listen, being a control freak, wanting to be in control of everything in your life is rebellion against Yeshua's kingship as your groom. Because the word says we need to surrender it to him. But listen to this. As the crowd begged Yeshua to leave, the word says, the man begged him to be with him. See, because the moment you embrace the miracle, you find yourself in that presence of a sovereign God. You find yourself in the presence of the great I Am. You fall in love with the one who created you. And this man begged Yeshua. Because Yeshua said, okay, it's fine. And he got into the ship. And the man ran to the ship and said, Yeshua, I want to go with you. And he says, no, you can't go with me. Because I'm going to send you into this place. Because I'm leaving. But I'm going to send you into this place to testify. Tell them what happened to you. Tell them what Abba Father did in your life. And not many people know this. In Yeshua's ministry on earth, this possessed man that lived amongst the tombs and the swine was the very first missionary Yeshua sent to do missionary work. Even before he sent out the 12, even before he sent out the 70, he sent out this man. And he says, go and testify, tell them. And you read later on. It's in the region of 2 or 3 years later, when Yeshua returns to that area, all the people were hungry to hear him preach. Because the seed was sown by somebody that was changed in the presence. The ground was prepared by a previously demonic possessed man. Stepping into the presence of the great I Am, being changed. And that whole area changed. Their hearts changed. They became hungry for the gospel. They became hungry to hear Yeshua speak. Because the next time he went across to that area, they wanted to listen to him. They wanted to eat from his word. We fear many times for the miracle. Because it's that trust place that I'm stepping in. That I'm not sure of what Abba Father's going to do. Because he doesn't give me a 10-year plan. He tells me to trust him for tomorrow and today. And it's okay, because he knows my hair count. He knows every hair on my body. He knows every hair on your head. And while he's keeping the hair count, he's running the universe. That's the King we serve. You see, last night I asked Abba Father, I said, Abba Father, why are we so scared of miracles sometimes? And he says, because my children are scared of change. My children are scared of change. Because when we enter his presence, we always face change. But if you embrace, and I saw this as every time I see this, and this year again I see this in Israel, as the people journey with the Most High, with El Elyon, I see the change. I feel the change in myself. I see the change in those around me. I see the physical change. Because you get to that place where you just walk in his presence for 10 or 12 days, allowing him to do what he wants to do. And of course, it can happen here. It can happen anywhere. You need to go there to experience the change. But you need to be set apart. You need to set time aside to spend in his presence so that he can change you. And that's why so many times you see that. And every evening in Israel, when I go to bed, I say, Lord, I adore you, Daddy. I love you so much, Lord, and even though, Lord, I'm tired, Lord. Even though in the physical, Lord, I feel like falling down and just going to sleep for 3 days. I see you move, Daddy. I see you move, Daddy. And that's amazing. So therefore, Abba Father, please, grant me the grace to rise again tomorrow and continue this journey. You see, because we got to make no mistake. He encounters us in order to change us. In his presence, you're going to change. That's how it is. But the one requiring the change is the one who spoke one word in Mark 5 and a whole legion of demonic forces moved. What can he do in your life and my life? The one who requires us to change is the same one who spoke one word and the storms calmed. Who spoke one word and the blind saw. Who spoke one word and the lame walked. Who spoke one word and the seas opened. Why are we scared of that change? Because we lose control? Because I don't see my peaks anymore? I don't have my peak count? Everything in the natural. It's that change when we realize that our lives will never be the same again. And in the last 12 days, I saw that over and over and over again. I saw people bowing in the presence of the King, saying that I don't have the ability to do this. And 4 hours later, yes, he gave me strength to push victories on high mountains as we ascended, victories in valleys low as we descended. Bowing in the presence of our King at this altar of worship and prayer. He changes you when you enter presence every time. So when you get into your car today, know that He's there. And if we encounter Him, He's going to change us. And last night, Abba Father said this to me. He says to me, what if what would happen, Harry, and listen to this, if my children opposed to living in the fear of what if, they live in the faith of even if. Let that sink in for a moment. What if we push out the fear of what if? What if this? What if this happens? What if that happens? What if we push that out and walk in the faith of even if this happens, I'm going to be okay because I'm in the hands of the great I am. You see, we've got to see, like Paul says, the wiles of the enemy. We've got to see the tactic of the enemy. We've got to see the tactic of the enemy that he's trying to do. The moment we receive a touch from Yahweh, the moment we receive a touch from the great I am, He comes in an area of our lives to try and threaten us. Whether it be your health, your finance, your relationship, doesn't matter. He wants to try and get us to back off and send Yeshua away. But if we persevere and push, we will go to all nations and make people disciples. We will do the work of godly purpose. We'll do the work that Abba Father has for us. In Mark 5, prosperity or love? They chose prosperity. And many times we do that. But the man who lived amongst the tombs, you see, he didn't want Yeshua for what Yeshua could do for him. He just had this desire to be in his presence. He just wanted to be with Yeshua. Can we see this picture? Let us close our eyes and just ask Abba Father just to touch us in the way that He wants. Let us stand together. And let's just listen.
When my world is shaken, You are my firm foundation. You are my rock of ages. Jesus, you are. When my world is shaken, you are my firm foundation. You are my rock of ages. Jesus, you are. In every
experience the Lord laying it on my heart just to say to you this morning, and I know many of us need to hear this. The Lord is saying, don't be afraid of my touch. I'm not going to hurt you. Don't be afraid of my change in your life. It's going to be in line with your godly purpose. I experienced the Lord saying, don't be afraid of the miracle. Have a father laid on my heart to say, let's embrace his fullness. Let's trust him to be in control. Experience the King of Glory saying today, can he tell my children, few will choose presence, because if you read Mark 5, on the one side there's the man, on the other side was the crowd. And isn't that what the word says? The road that leads to this intimacy, the salvation, is narrow and few will go there. But the broad way where many will go, the crowd will go, will lead to destruction. And if Abba Father touched you, cherish that in your heart. Warfare over it, don't let it go. Don't let the enemy steal through fear. Let's push out the fear of what if and replace it with the faith of even if. Because my King is in control. There's a joy about to erupt in the bride of Messiah. Because Yeshua is coming to fetch a bride without spot or blemish. And he's calling us. He's calling us by name. And saying, rise in this time. Don't be afraid. Don't be afraid to run into my presence. Run to me as the man ran to me in his present condition of bondage and hurt. In his present condition of darkness and loneliness, he ran to the King of Glory. And when they saw him again, he sat in the presence at the feet of Messiah, drinking from the words of the living word himself, Yeshua. He never left again. He never left again because everything changed. Everything changed. Because everything changes in presence. More and more every day. Abba Father, pour your spirit into us, Lord. Abba Father. Here where you are, just cry out to him. Just speak to him and just say to him, Lord, I accept every change you want in my life, Lord, because I know it's for the good, Lord. Your time with the King. Pour it out, pour it out. We're ready to see your power come through again. With humble hearts, we turn away from our sin. So pour it out right now, Holy Spirit. Pour it out. Yeah. God. Father, thank you, Daddy God, that we stand before you, Abba Father, and we stretch out our arms, Abba Father, and we say, Daddy God, we accept, Abba Father, everything that you pour out on us right now. We drink it, Abba Father. Love you, Daddy God. Thank you, Abba Father, that this morning we run to you without hesitance. No matter what the crowd says, we will do what you say, Lord. Receive the blessing, Abba Father, and go in his peace. May the Lord bless you and keep you, and may he make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. And may he lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. May you walk in his presence. And may he change us every day more and more like the image of the great I Am. May we display his character in everything we do. All in worshiping him. In the mighty name of Yeshua. Amen.